BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
NAP Connection is a panel discussion on selected art and art issues with your guest and a host, Ron Schira. Home viewers are invited to call in during the live telecast and offer comments or questions of the artist. NAP Connection is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit art service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. The New Arts Program is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
And hello, greetings. Welcome to NAP Connections. I'm your host, Ron Schira. Now, we're going to be speaking with an artist today, Matthew Garrison. Hello, Matt. How
hello,
are you?
Hello, Ron. Great to be here.
Nice to have you here. So what we're going to be doing is looking at Matthew's work as it is taking place right now. It's being shown right now at the gallery, at Friedman Gallery of Albright College. And it's going to be there for a couple weeks yet, right?
Till March 6th.
Till March 6th.
March 6th, yeah.
So okay.
Opened relatively recently.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. So feel free, and we encourage you to go and take a look at the show, because it's quite an interesting show, I think. Matthew's a conceptual artist based in materials, and the work itself is called Nothing Left of Time, which is the name of the exhibition, and we have that. We have his sign up there, so we'll be showing works from that, and that's pretty much it.
Okay,
let's get down to it. Tell us about yourself.
Well, I'm an artist. I grew up in Chicago and lived in New York for many years. Worked for artists and galleries and paid my dues like a lot of us. Found an opportunity here in Reading to teach at Albright College, and so that brought me here. And now I have a studio in the area and continue to make art and exhibit.
Mm-hmm. So what do you teach over at Albright?
Digital media and art.
Yeah, which is quite a job, really, because digital media is really burgeoned over the last couple of years.
It has, yeah. Mm-hmm. And I've been there for some years now, and I've watched the technology evolve over time, and the students become more and more savvy, which is great. It keeps me on my toes, and it's good. It's really good.
Yeah, I really like digital art, and I've only just seen myself because I like using video. And for a while, I did some documentation of the area by going around to studios and artists' lofts and ateliers, and did a lot of documentation. And even in that short amount of time that I was doing that, I noticed how the technology was improving, not even from year to year, but month to month.
Yes, absolutely.
It was going
absolutely
very quickly.
Yes, yeah. And I would say that, you know, people are often defined as digital nomads or digital natives, right? The digital nomad is someone who grew up before technology sort of became a part of everybody's lives. And then the digital native are those who are younger who grew up with technology.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm very much a nomad. So I think my work reflects that. It has the hands-on quality of sculpture, painting, photography, and also technology.
Well, yours is more multimedia. You have a lot. You have a lot involved because you have digital works in the show.
I do. Yes.
Yeah. And some of the work is sculptural. Some, and, but it incorporates painting. It incorporates, you know, physicality.
Right.
So there's some of the pieces are just really quite, you know, complex. Not just in their ideology, but in their manufacture. So
absolutely,
yeah.
And a lot of materials, from sculptural, woodworking, found materials, drawing, painting. But I think of it more as a sort of paint relief, because it's not the traditional application of paint where an image emerges or a sort of abstraction occurs.
Right.
It's more. The paint's poured on, it's sculpted because it's soaked in cotton, flattened with clamps. So there's a whole sort of physicality to its realization.
And we'll be showing some of those.
All right.
Yeah. So the basic philosophy of this stuff is the physicality versus what would you say, the relationship that you have to it. Tell us more about that.
Sure. Well, the work, it kind of exists in two worlds, much like we do, right?
Right.
We have our real world and the people that we encounter, like the conversation right now, and then a world online.
Yeah.
And that's and the work sort of speaks to both of those, because I think that really is a major part of everyone's experience at this point, or many people's experience.
And lately, more so lately than before, we're having a lot more exposure to things like Zoom conferences, you know, Google Meetups, that sort of thing. And there's all kinds of different programs that approach that, where I mean, Zoom is the most popular one lately, but we've seen a few of them. I use some different programs myself for that, because I have friends that are, you know, in Japan and you know, in Sweden, and it just seems that, you know, that you have what can I say?
It's sort of this compression of space and time, really.
Yeah.
Because they may be 12 hours ahead of us in Japan, but right, we're meeting sort of incredibly online. So it's this sort of real-time interaction where space and time kind of fold in on one another. And I think the show also kind of touches on that. And two general ways of thinking about the show upon entering it would be moving from an interior to an exterior. So you, if you turn left when you walk into the gallery, you're met with hundreds of empty rooms. Then as you move through the gallery, you find yourself outside in this sort of skyscape. And then further along, if you keep going around, you find that you're also sort of moving from day to night. So you have two things happening, an inside or interior and exterior world.
Right.
Or the world we create for ourselves and then the world that's out there. And then time, day and night, are all folded in together.
Has a lot to do with that, with time. And a lot of the works that are in this, especially we have one up here right now, which I'd like to present. The title for this is what?
Be Right Back.
Be Right Back.
Yes.
Okay, so we can't zoom in on this, can we? But no, it's. But I think I have some close-ups, a little. Yeah, here we go.
There we go. Okay.
See. Now these are just like waiting periods, like when you're online with somebody and they say, I'll be right back, and they walk away, the camera's still on, and they're still sending an image from anywhere, and it's on your computer, and you're getting a chance to see the inner domicile. You're getting to see where they live, what their interests are, and pictures on their wall, their messy beds, et cetera. All of that. So say a little bit about that.
Sure. First of all, there are people I don't know. I go into public chat rooms, and there are people who just put themselves out there into the public with their computer, and then if they step away, I'll take a screenshot. And I love the idea of this private and public space, that there's an anonymity both in my relationship to them and the room and the absence of them in their room. So we get to know them through their absence, the residue. And that's a lot of what's in the show, sort of our fingerprints or what we leave behind and how that sort of interacts in our own personal world as well as the world that might be nature or the environment.
Yes, yes. Well, because it is their environment, it's where they live.
Right, right.
So you're more or less kind of like capturing or maybe even stealing, the place where they live. And that's, that's almost like a zoo-like, ideology. Let's look at the animals in their natural habitat here.
But they put themselves out there. So it's a public, for example, if we were in a Zoom meeting, I wouldn't do that. And I wouldn't even, and if it wouldn't, it would be, I would feel uncomfortable doing that because there's a trust factor there.
Right.
But when it's an international anonymous space and public, I think there's something happening here.
They're giving you that.
They're putting themselves out there. So that's what, and I like the controversy and that it makes people uncomfortable. And people have strong reactions to that idea. And I welcome that because that's part of the work, is that reaction. That's the conversation that inevitably will inevitably happen in this work.
See, but they don't know really that they're being eavesdropped on.
They do. They're out there, and it's a chat room where they just put themselves. It's open to anybody to. I think a lot of them are trying to become influencers. They try to be online personalities. So they're, even though they're starting out, they're public figures.
Right.
So it's just they're out there, and it's public, and it's just like tuning into a channel. It just happens to be them promoting themselves.
From their bedrooms, from their dining rooms.
Right.
Yeah, yeah. Most of these people are doing it actually from very private places, like the one picture that we have here is, it looks like most of them are bedrooms. Okay, there's another angle. There's somebody's bicycle hanging from the ceiling.
Right.
You know? I mean, it's just, you get an idea. I heard it said by an article I read in a flash art magazine that there was a European artist who was making paintings and photographs about the about objects. Say, like, for instance, we use the washing machine, because we were talking about that before, but you wanted to talk about a washing machine, so you don't see the washing machine. But you see a basket of laundry, you see soap, detergent, that sort of thing. And you see all of the accoutrements of what it takes to do your laundry, the laundry room and all of this stuff, but you don't you don't see the washing machine or the dryer itself, but the title of the work would be washing machine.
Right. Yeah, you know? There's definitely a relationship here.
Right.
But in my case, it's a personality. You get to know a person through their absence in a way. And that's and that's a theme that's throughout the show, and that the presence of humanity is in a lot of the work, but there are no people in the work. So it's just our residue on the sky, in the night, in a field. It's like just our presence out there.
Yeah, yeah, and sending it out digitally as well. Mm-hmm. So that's another another thing, because you're now reduced to an image, reduced to an electronic transmission. Mm-hmm. But the other part of that is that it's from anywhere. Mm-hmm. You know, like you were saying earlier about from Japan, you know, or from Great Britain. It's like you can be talking to anybody at any time from anywhere, as long as they have the technology to support it.
Right, right.
Yeah.
It's this compression of time and space.
And the, henceforth the title of your show.
Yeah, Nothing Left of Time.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's actually sort of an title comes from somebody that many people in Reading will be familiar with, Wallace Stevens, the poet who grew up on North Fifth Street, right around the corner from where we're talking. Mm-hmm. And I figured out the title through his poetry. It's from a poem called Credences of Summer.
Right.
And then I started to look further into his own biography and then realized he's from Reading. And I'm like, well, that's perfect.
Yeah.
And
there is a Wallace Stevens chapter here too.
Yeah. So the title is a response to that incredible poem, which I felt also encapsulates some of the ideas that are in the show.
I was reminded also of Marcel Proust, you know, and in Remembrance of Things Past, that it's like you're using memory too as a way of bringing this into the foreground, because you have a ghost-like presence in many of this stuff.
Yes.
So it's like you can tell that a person was there.
Right.
So that when they do show up, you get to see their personalities. Mm-hmm. You may not even know their language. I had been listening to a pianist from Poland. Her name is Hania Rani. Beautiful piano work. Oh, my God, you know, puts me to tears. But when she comes on YouTube, what I see her on, she speaks in Polish. I don't even have it. I have no clue what she's saying.
Uh-huh.
But she'll stand there, look right at the camera, and talk to you, you know, in her native tongue, and that's...
Right.
Yeah. So, you know, so it's like... it's also a good thing to do, to learn and to be able to communicate with anybody from around the world. You have to learn the language.
Right.
And sometimes you don't know the language, but you can get a sense of the person.
Sure. And she communicates through her music, so we don't even need to know Polish to understand probably the thing that's central to her life. By listening to her art. I think that's the power of art, that we can communicate across languages.
I don't have to hear what she says in order to understand what she's trying to say through her her music. So I moved on to the next image here.
Okay.
You want to tell us about this one?
Sure. This is a small piece. It's 8.5 by 11 inches, and this is at Albright, where I teach. And this is actually from a quiz that I gave to my students. It's the extra credit question. And I just thought that was a nice sort of full circle to bring that into the gallery, and maybe somebody will recognize it. But it's, it's basically, the quiz got torn, the paper was torn, and I just was sort of intrigued by how it, because, you know, paper's so thin, but it tore in such a way that you could see a little bit of the text on the other side of it, and then you can pick that up a little bit on the right. And then the hand is one of my students' hands.
Right.
And it's it's kind of like she's raising her hand to answer a question. So you have some of those things going on. But also, like in a lot of these pieces, there's a lot of tension, a lot of questions are raised. Why, you know, other people have looked at this piece and have thought of the phrase "hands up," right? So it has that kind of thing happening simultaneously, and I kind of welcome that. I love it when people bring other ideas to the work, because for me, the work is meant to raise questions. It provides a conduit to the imagination, to memory, things like that. And so for me, when I put this out there, I'm hoping people bring their own experience. It sort of interacts with them and their experiences, and then they can find that in the work as well.
And it's somewhat ambiguous too, because there's a dark area next to the forefinger on the right side, which is somewhat disconcerting, because it makes it look like it's an extra finger.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. For me, it's like sort of a portal, or like there's a space behind it, like something cavernous, or even, and I don't know if she's inside or outside, but there's a, but there is a space that's happening behind the page itself.
And although the second hand, the one that's a little smaller towards the central left, upon first glance, when I first looked at this, I thought it was a heart.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, not like a Valentine's Day's heart, you know.
Right.
But a real
anatomical
beating heart.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it had that impression to me until I looked at it a little further. But then all of the blue in it kind of like, it doesn't disguise it so much as it augments it. And I was wondering, did you choose that color deliberately, or is that something that just sort of found its way in?
It's deliberate in that blue is thematic in my work, because I think of the sky very often,
right?
And we'll see that in other work as well. But for me, the blue is definitely, the hand is sort of grounded in one world, and then there's another world that's kind of implied by the blue, by that negative space, and an intellectual world, because it comes from a quiz. So people were studying and hopefully knew what the answer might be. And in this case, I don't know if you can see from the slide, but the check mark is the artist Fred Sandbach. There's a sort of an art history layering happening here as well.
Yeah, I know his work. Yes, it's a beautiful piece. I really do like it.
Thank you.
Let's move on to the next one here. Now, this one here, I don't know if we can see it as well, but this has a classical reference, doesn't it?
Yeah, this was originally shown outdoors on 60th Street and 59th Street on a wrought iron fence on the outside of the Church of St. Paul the Apostle in New York City.
Right, because those bars correlate to the fence that's encircles the building.
Yes, exactly. So mm-hmm. when I removed the piece from its location, I wanted it to have a second life, although it was wonderful to see it on the streets, because mm-hmm. I don't know if it's clear from the slide, but there's a mirror behind the bars. So mm-hmm. people would, when they walked by it on the street, would literally stop, startled, and see mm-hmm. themselves behind bars. So it was a real, and it was really nice to see that kind of interaction.
But you had people taking selfies and stuff. Well,
yes, I yeah. found that if you put a mirror on the street, people will take selfies. Mm-hmm. So that was part of the discovery process for me. But
the selfie is also an interesting phenomenon. It seems like everybody in the world does them.
Yes.
I try not to do them personally mm-hmm. because I figure that I've got my face is out there enough.
Sure. You know? Right. But to come back to your question, it was something about the classical sort of source for this idea. And when I knew it was going to be outside a church, I thought of artists like Michelangelo and, mm-hmm. of course, Raphael and all of these artists associated with the church. Mm-hmm. And a piece that has always captivated me was Raphael's Liberation of St. Peter in Vatican City. Mm-hmm. And it's a powerful piece because the gate or the prison that he's in is this kind of grid of wrought iron. And the title of the piece that I made here is Liberation of the Saint. So mm-hmm. St. Peter becomes the saint, and those who look into the mirror then become a saint. So there's that sort of, for a moment anyways, we can embody something of a saint. And then that when we look away, there's a release. I don't know if we remain or if there's a transformation, but that was sort of the starting point for the idea behind mm-hmm. this piece.
Like a release from captivity.
Right.
You're behind bars, but you're behind bars just the same as the Raphael. Mm-hmm. Relevance toward the saint that has been imprisoned.
Yeah, and then also, if you look inside this, it has a blue background, which is the same blue that we'll see in the clouds a little later. Mm-hmm. And the edges are green astroturf. So you're looking into this very artificial world, and you're seeing yourself in that world. And then again, when you step away, you're in the real world. So like we were talking about with the online experience, there are two things happening. What the moment we enter the space, and then the awareness, hopefully, that it creates of our actual space around us.
Mm-hmm. It's an interesting piece. The blue washes out a little bit because of the flash of the camera. Mm-hmm. But this thing held up really well considering it was outside for so long.
It was outside for a couple months.
Yeah.
And I spent a lot of time weatherproofing this because it was in the summer and spring, so it had a lot of rain on it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But it held up.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. It looks like a little bit of stainage on the corners of it, but it seems like it's disappearing. It's like fading into the background of the grain.
Yeah.
It's like you almost don't even really see it. There's like a balance between both corners that mm-hmm. kind of like brings it in together.
Yeah, that's just the gesture made by the experience of being outside.
Right.
That was not me. That was just weathering.
That was nature.
Yes.
Yeah.
And it seems, as you mentioned, it seems to be dissipating because when I first brought it inside, it was much darker.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe in another couple years that will go away.
It'll soak in and dry out.
Yeah. I like it. So
I like it too. Yeah, I think it's really.
Yeah, I like the stain, like that dark stain. We'll see what happens.
Mm-hmm. Then we'll go to the next one here.
Okay.
Oh, that.
Can we rotate
that? Yeah, can we rotate
Command
this?
Command R, maybe.
Uh, There we go.
All righty. Yeah. So this is on a wall of an accumulation of pieces like this, of different cloud formations. Mm-hmm. And this one was one of the early ones. It was one of the, I had the idea that I wanted to have this sort of skyscape that contradicted everything we know about the sky. So right. It's very physical, they're very heavy. The paint that's used is house paint. So I can be generous in pouring. I don't brush it on, I pour it on and scrape it and spread it. So it's a very physical process in its realization. The cloud itself is, the paint is soaked, or I soak cotton in the paint, and then I mold that form. Mm-hmm. And then I take a heavy sheet of wood, place it on top, and clamp it down. And that's how you get that real flat sensation from on the cloud. So it's it's made out of a paint, but it's the paint is treated as a material more than an illusion. The other thing is, if you look in the right lower corner, somebody's taken a bite out of the sky. So the title of this piece is called Bite the Sky. And it's that idea of there's an environmental theme kind of running through the show.
Right.
And, you know, when we were looking at the photo pieces, these are the things that we sort of live with and leave behind and disregard and that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Things that kind of live in the peripheral of our vision that we're not even aware of. And then suddenly somebody recognizes it and it becomes meaningful somehow.
Well, the clouds, yeah. it seems to like float on the sky. And yeah. that's one of the other aspects of this that I like, is that it's almost like an applique. Like you can you put it on, or you know, you glue it, you nail it, mm-hmm. or however it positions the paint itself sticks to the canvas.
Right. Although it's not canvas, it's wood.
Wood. I'm sorry.
Yeah. No. It's I'll tell you the process of this is it's two sheets of half inch wood mm-hmm. that are laminated together. The cloud is cut out of the top sheet. So when they're first laminated together, you have an empty space where the cloud will be. Mm-hmm. And then I construct the cloud by molding it with this combination of cotton and paint. So it's a very sort of laborious or labor-intensive process.
Mm-hmm. I was just going to say that.
And as the pieces get bigger, it becomes, and it also takes a very long time to dry because the cloud is over an inch thick of paint, almost solid paint.
Right.
And it'll take, for it to dry all the way through, it probably takes at least 3 months. But once it dries for a couple weeks, I can start working into it again. Mm-hmm. And I like that you can press and as it's partially dry, you can start to manipulate it that way. And
do you cut it with a jigsaw, or do you model it with your hands? Or
the wood is cut with a jigsaw. Yeah, table saw cuts out the two big sheets of ply. Uh-huh. Jigsaw cuts out the shape of the cloud for the top sheet of plywood. Mm-hmm. Glue them together. Clean up the edges, cut the bite out in the corner.
I was going to say, you didn't just bite it out of the corner.
No. And then the cloud itself is built into that form. And once the cloud is built, then I pour the sky on.
Ah, I see. Okay. Now this one here.
So we're moving, we're outside again. Now we're outside. This piece is called Nest. And this is made out of concrete. Then there's a digital print on in the background that's curved inside the cavity of that concrete. So it's like a concrete U shape, maybe, but with right angles.
And right, it's like a tube that's surrounded by concrete. This actually extends, you can't see the sides of it here, but it actually extends from the wall about maybe 6 to 8 inches.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yep.
So now the colors that are inside the curvature of the concrete, mm-hmm. is that image a digital print?
It's two things. There's a painting
uh-huh.
that's curved, and then there's a digital print on acetate on top of the painting.
Ah.
And so what's happening is the painting somewhat reflects the print, but it also adds and changes the print and helps to saturate the colors. The colors are already oversaturated intentionally. Mm-hmm. And then this just pushes it to the next level by having that layering of almost a toxic hue in the background.
Right. It's very acidic.
Yeah.
But that actually adds to its presence, mm-hmm. I think.
Right.
Now that's a real bird's nest, though.
It is, yeah. And the bird's nest, I've had that nest for about 20 years. So my mother knows me. She gave me a box, and this was a long time ago, over like 20 years ago. And in the box, I open it up, and there's a bird skull and a bird's nest. And I'm like, this is great. I don't know what I'm going to do with it, but it's so thoughtful. For some reason, she thought
mm-hmm.
that would appeal to, and it did.
Yeah, yeah.
And I just held on to it.
Nobody knows you like your mother.
Exactly. And then I took the skull is still in a box, so maybe someday that'll find a place mm-hmm. in a sculpture or something. But the nest I took out and put next to my music box, where for my CDs,
mm-hmm.
and there it sat. So it was always kind of, again, in my peripheral and my thinking, and I coated it with paint so it became this thick block, this object,
mm-hmm.
And then the nest was nested in that sort of universe inside the concrete structure.
Okay. Now moving on to this piece.
Mm-hmm.
Now this has different geometric qualities to it. You got a square and a circle inside of a square. The green astroturf, which is split into four like window-like panels. And mm-hmm. then you have a photograph of, it looks like a toy horse.
It is a toy horse, yes.
Yeah.
It was photographed with a macro lens so I could enlarge it. Because
mm-hmm.
I wanted the toy horse to be roughly life size.
Mm-hmm.
This piece is just shy of 4 by 4 feet.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a big, pretty substantial piece. And here we have AstroTurf making another appearance.
Mm-hmm.
And the circle, not unlike the concrete, helps us to focus on something.
Right.
In my mind, it's like a portal or a lens. It sort of shifts between the two. I started seeing circles emerge in my work.
Mm-hmm.
So I start looking up symbolic meaning for circles and mechanical meaning. I'm like, no. It's a portal and it's a lens for me. For other people, maybe they'll find other meaning.
Well, looking at something as, through your glasses or through mm-hmm. a lens, it always has a sort of a vignette quality of like spreading outward.
Right.
You don't really see things in a square fashion. The square mm-hmm. Is something that has been invented, through art and geometry.
Mm-hmm.
So it seems that a circle is a little bit more natural.
That's nice.
You
closer to mm-hmm. the source of nature, which is kind of where, which is where this is coming from, the
right.
work.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a, it's an artificial interpretation of nature.
Right. Right.
It's our assertion. It's an assertion of ourselves on the environment. And in this case, I became interested. I always like that term that photographers use. We've all heard of bird's eye view.
Right.
But there's also a worm's eye view image, which mm-hmm. is when you, the most popular one might be looking up through trees in the woods, and you have that really exaggerated perspective. But I wanted to think of worm's eye more literally. So here I thought, well, here's a worm's eye view looking through a window pane in the yard or the grass or wherever the field, wherever it may be. And looking back is this horse. And the horse is, it's obviously not a real horse, but I think the scale throws people off because for a split second, you feel like it's real.
Mm-hmm.
And then the background, of course, has this almost 1940s Brigitte Bardot kind of haze when they come in on, you know, on a close-up. So it has that, it's playing with some of those things that we associate with cinema and we have built into our subconscious visual vocabulary.
Mm-hmm.
But it also inverts everything we expect, right? We look out a window, we don't expect that window to be looking through the earth like this. We don't expect the horse to be looking back.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
This sort of, I don't know if it's a horse that is a wild horse or somebody's horse, but looking back, and all of it is, it sort of comes out of this sense of humor, but also there's a whimsical quality to it, but also maybe a romantic quality in terms of coming back to Raphael. I love that sort of Renaissance art and that history, and I pull from some of those, I guess the palette, the space, the sensibility of some of that, and apply it to something both contemporary and surprising.
Okay, I'm going to move on because I want to get all of these images in there. We already got.
We saw that one. Uh-oh.
Oops! Here we
there
go
he
again.
Is.
Don't you just love this? Okay. Now, that's you.
That's me, yes.
And there's an installation shot in the gallery at the opening of the gallery. Mm-hmm. And this is the final piece in the show, which is kind of like the transitionary piece from day into evening.
Correct.
So you have the circle, which I suppose would signify either the sun or the moon.
Could be, yes.
Possibly.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And the dark lines would be the transitionary phase of night into day.
Exactly, yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this piece is called Daybreak.
Mm-hmm.
And this wall is painted black because this is the wall that, this is the nighttime wall.
Ah.
And this one piece, as you said it perfectly, it's a transition from day to night. But in my world, it's not a sunrise or a sunset. It's breaking out, almost like a jailbreak. And here, nighttime is portrayed as bars, and daytime is portrayed as this space behind those bars. And there's a literal kind of breaking through of one time into the next time.
In reference to your gate, to your fence piece.
Exactly. Yeah, they're opposite each other in the gallery.
Mm-hmm.
So they sort of, and all of these pieces speak together. It's something that's really, I think a lot about how they'll converse with one another and what they add to the conversation about interior and exterior, about environmental issues and our impact on the environment, whether we just casually leave something behind and don't think about it, or bite the sky that kind of thing. So there's all of that sort of happening as one sort of encounters these ideas are all woven together.
Okay.
Oh, there's the install.
This is the installation view.
Yeah.
So we can speak a little bit about this. The yellowish orange piece up towards the upper left is a signification of the sun, maybe?
In this context, it is. Mm-hmm. Yes, because there's a sort of circuitry construction of sky. Again, everything sort of contradicting itself in terms of what we know and what we see. Mm-hmm. And in this case, of course, one would think of the sun as being round, so I square it off and give it these jagged edges rather than these sort of rays of sun that one would normally associate with it. And again, our fingerprints are here, our handprints, in that those lines on the surface are collaged, they're not painted.
Mm-hmm.
And they're the source of those lines are the lifeline, the heart line, in our hands.
Your palms.
And the palms of the hands. So there's a lot of people, and they're all their hands, all those palms are woven together in this piece. So like some of the other work, it's this fusion of humanity.
Right. And this is the installation view of it. So we're talking maybe like 8 by 12 feet or something, maybe?
Maybe even bigger than that.
Maybe even bigger than
well,
that.
Well, I think they're 10-foot ceilings.
Mm-hmm.
And the clouds that go highest are going over the molding at the top.
Right.
Because I'm trying, mm-hmm. and you'll notice there's another one that's like shoved in the corner. So I'm very aware of the architecture.
Mm-hmm.
They're not just floating to be in relation to one another, but they're in relation to the room, in relation to the other work.
Now that the large mauve pipe shape that's off to the side there, that's off to the right, that is not really a pipe, that's actually a signification of smoke?
That was where it was coming from.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. The piece, it's same materials as all the others,
uh-huh.
except in this case, the smoke, or the cotton is using this deep, rich purple paint. So you have that physicality. The title of this piece is Smokestack.
Okay.
And that's where day transitions into night in the gallery. Above the smoke, you have a beautiful blue sky, and then, of course, below the smoke, it gets darker. And that was something.
There's a better picture.
Oh, yeah, there's the, there's that. I call this piece hand study, but in the context of this show, it also serves as a sun, or in my mind, the light source for the entire show.
It's very bright, and it does. It literally lights up that entire corner.
Mm-hmm.
And those red, orange lines in there, those are all the wrinkles of your palm.
Right.
The little jaggedy stuff here is like, that is the only separation of the geometric quality of the circle that mm-hmm. would signify the sun or the otherwise.
Mm-hmm.
But this way it transitions that into art, with the rectangularity of it. And all of those lines are cut out.
Yes. So, yeah. And adhered with an industrial epoxy. So
wow, that's a lot of work.
It is, yeah. Yeah.
So, now this piece here, I don't know if we can I guess that's as good as it's gonna get.
All right.
There we go. Now this piece here has a fishing rod.
Yes.
And the fishing rod is down at the far, end of this, like, what would you call it, tableau?
Sure.
Where you have a pipe that's coming up at the end. It seems like it has a couple of different references here. And you can't really see the fishing line that is stressed and stretched from the top of the fishing rod as it goes into that little pipe that's positioned at the bottom here. Now that, for some reason, it strikes me, you know, two or three different ways. It's like, for one, it looks like it could be a putting green, you know,
right.
That you know. But being that the pipe is above the grass, the astroturf there, there's no way that it could fall in. It'll bounce off of it every time.
Right.
Now, since the cord of the fishing rod goes inside of that pipe, it's kind of like you're reaching inside of the pipe for something, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It could be an idea, it could be, you know, well, it could be anything, literally. Mm-hmm. And this is it's an interesting conceptual juxtaposition. Tell us a little bit.
Sure. Yeah. So the fishing rod is curved because there's tension on it, and the line is being so it's caught something in the pipe. So we don't know what it is. And the title of the piece is Quarantine. I was in quarantine, like everyone, when I made this.
Yeah.
And I wanted to somehow convey that frustration of being inside, wanting to be outside, and having just limitations on where you can go and what you can do and what you might do if you weren't in quarantine. So we had all these things coming to into play here. And I thought, well, if someone wanted to go fishing and they couldn't go anywhere, right? This is PVC pipe,
right?
Which could also be for your septic tank. So this would be like a what if one were to fish in their septic tank. So it's like a lot of the work has this sort of uncomfortable quality to it.
Right, it makes you feel uneasy.
And there's this one has a gag behind it, but I totally agree. It could also be a putting green, which I like, and I like the frustration of it being a dysfunctional putting green.
Mm-hmm. Unattainable.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So it's all part of the same idea, just coming at it from a different direction.
Mm-hmm. And also has that, you know, being that it's the idea of a septic tank, and what we've been experiencing now for the last 2 years with the COVID epidemic, it's like fishing in doo-doo, you know, trying to find something, you know, in the waste.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. And then on an environmental level, there are populations and communities that have been neglected, where they don't have proper septic systems. And so they, you know, that's a very serious and real issue here in the United States, which is shocking.
Which is shocking, yeah. We have a lot of issues in the United States that need to be taken care of.
Yeah. So I think all of that becomes part of the discussion.
So what else do we have here as we go through this? All right. Now we can't really see the bottom of this. And I don't know what happened to that photograph. I did have one. But there's the video part of this, which you can see a little bit down at the bottom, has a recording of some deer that are, you know, in the dark, in the night, and they're foraging, you know, looking for something to eat, I suppose. And the circular part of it, like that's not really a moon that's there on the bottom, but it's a scope that's in the video. It kind of like scoots around looking for things, and it's catching these deer in night vision. And that's What's the story behind that?
Sure. This one is called Nightlife.
Uh-huh.
And it's a play on our associations of nightlife, maybe going to a club or going out with friends. But uh-huh. here it's nightlife, literally nightlife, with wilderness.
Right.
And what I would do is just use a trail camera and move it around to get over the mm-hmm. course of an entire year. So I would try to get a far shot from up high, then I would put it down low or along the ground to try to get sort of maybe a worm's eye view again of
right.
something.
Mm-hmm.
So I was moving this around through all four seasons. So if you were to watch all 14 minutes and 23 seconds of the video,
right.
you would see the deer interacting through the seasons.
Right.
And
we're running out of time, or we would show it.
Oh yeah, well you can see the circle in the right corner of the screen. It's just as the deer gets up and moves, the circle will follow,
mm-hmm.
and then another deer will cross, and there'll be this choreography of deer and circles and compression of time as well.
I see.
And this piece has been shown a fair amount. It's been shown in New York, Singapore, mm-hmm. Panama, India. So it's been out there.
Mm-hmm. It's an interesting piece. I would have liked to have started it earlier. And this one here we have to speak about.
Right. This is the earliest piece in the show. It's from 2001.
Mm-hmm.
But I wanted to show some continuity over time. Because with so many ideas sort of in conversation, I thought to just show that these ideas have been developing and evolving for some time now. And on the left, this close-up that we're looking at, you can see drawings of raindrops, essentially, in graphite or pencil. Mm-hmm. Then I cut the drop out and label the negative, the cutout, with a post-it and give it a number.
Mm-hmm.
And then on the right side, I will line them up in order. So this piece deals with this impossible task of counting raindrops. So it distills them, organizes them, and then presents them in order.
Very interesting. So,
yeah. So mm-hmm. this the show is up till March 6th,
mm-hmm.
and next Thursday, February 10th. At 4:00, I'll be doing an artist talk. So if you haven't seen enough already, you can see more.
Well, we encourage people to go see the show.
Right.
Just go and see it. Now, February the 10th would be a great time to do that, being that you're going to be there.
Right.
So that
right.
you'll answer any questions for
sure.
them.
Sure.
Whereas I'm having a few technical difficulties here, but this is a great show, and I would encourage anybody to go and take a look at this. I mean, really, right now, go look.
Mm-hmm.
You know, call college up, find out when the times are, or just go over.
Right.
You know,
right.
they might just say, yeah. "Okay, we'll let you in."
Mm-hmm.
So,
mm-hmm.
now I hope we covered this adequately, so because I'm giving the. I'm giving the time's up signal. The show is
okay.
Our show right now.
All right.
Technically over.
All right.
Doesn't have near enough time to conquer this entire repertoire of work. But I want to thank you, Matthew.
Well, I want to thank you.
Yeah. I thank you so much for being my guest here tonight.
Well, thank you. I really appreciate it. You walk the walk, talk the talk. You're a remarkable artist. And you're all in, so I really respect that.
you're too kind.
Yeah, and thank you for all these photos and coming and and you know, having this conversation.
I love it. I love it.
Yeah.
So, okay. Well, thank you very much for joining us here on NAP Connections. I'm your host, Ron Schira, with Matthew Garrison, teacher, artist at Albright College. We encourage you to go see the show, and there you go. Thank you very much for joining us, and have a wonderful evening.
All right, thank you.
NAP Connection originates from the Berks Community Television Studios in Reading, Pennsylvania. Please check your local listings for airtimes. For more information, please contact the New Arts Program at 610-683-6440 or visit the exhibition space at 173 West Main Street in Kutztown.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.